I want to first of all recall how we met. In the mid 90s, somebody from Bangalore called Mohan wrote me a letter, and he had attached with that a small booklet with a very long sounding name. I can't quite remember the name.
I can tell you that is Little Guide to Greater Glory and a Happy Life.
Yes.
That was this little
book. And with a letter saying that this is written by somebody called Mumtaz Ali M. And he would like to meet you when you next come to Bangalore. So I was impressed by the book. It's a very, very well-written book, as most of your books are. And so we wrote back to him and said, yeah, fine, such and such time at Raj Bhavan, Bangalore, where I'll be staying. And if I recall correctly, that is when you came. You were going off to America that evening.
Same. And you had just come back after a stint in the United States.
So that is where then I think you and this Mohan came. And we sat for a while and talked about the spiritual quest and the masters and so on and so on. And then that was our first meeting. It was, which, you know, was almost coincidental. I mean, it wasn't as if it was planned. But subsequently, an extraordinary thing happened that many people, particularly my wife's relatives, the interesting thing is that my wife's relatives on the Nepal side, whether it was, you know, the cousins, all cousins of one sort or the other, sisters or cousins, they all sort of gathered around you and got great inspiration. So I am happy that I was the conduit, as it were, to bring you and them together.
Yes, the other day I was telling Mohan, who seems to have sent the letter without my knowledge also.
Okay, yes.
That you are the one who now kind of entrapped me in this net. Now that I have to find time to move out and come in and just say where I'm going. Bharati was the first one to come to see me.
Okay.
With Suryadev in
Bangalore. Yes.
And she told me that you said to her that if you go to Bangalore, you must go and see M. This is how she came to me. And subsequently, over the years, as I started meeting you, and if you remember, you were the first person who organized my first satsang.
I remember that.
In Delhi.
In the Ramayana Vidyapeeth, if I remember correctly. Yes.
And the more I came to know you, I have a special relationship, I feel, towards you, which is not that of anything which normally people would think of. Which you have plenty, of course, but a spiritual relationship. Because I see that in spite of all your commitments and all that you do, you're somewhat like Janaka Maharshi trying to work out his own spiritual fulfillment also. Yes, to me, that is the core. That is the core of your personality, which is why I always come to see you whenever I come. I try to find out, in spite of your busy schedule, are you here?
And yes, that's very kind of you, actually. No, there is definitely a spiritual link. And I must say that I have benefited considerably from, not only from your books, but from personal contact. Because I think that this is an area where personal contact is really what counts. And we've had so many sessions, and we've been in my puja room several times. And I think that those vibrations go a long way.
But for me, whatever spiritual progress that I have and whatever I'm able to bring about in others is basically Babaji's blessings. Because I have told you many times that I had a great teacher called, whose real name was Maheshwar Nath, because he came from the Nath Sampradaya, but who was also a senior disciple of Babaji.
Of the original Babaji.
Whom in our parampara we call Shri Guru. And I think all this Mahavatar was a word coined by Yogananda Paramahamsa.
Yes.
Before that nobody knew him as Mahavatar. We call him Shri Guru. And somewhere Shri Guru is also linked to the Theosophists and to the masters the Theosophists talked about.
Yes.
I think somewhere in our past we do have a link.
Yes.
Probably has not yet been fully discovered, but I feel that Babaji has brought us together. Because I think everything that happens is done by him. It's not because of faith, because of my experience with him.
Well, you've been very fortunate that you've had that sort of a a sort of a guru. But you mentioned that there is link with the Theosophical Society. Actually, my great-grandfather, Maharaja Ranbir Singh, was, you saw his photographs, very impressive person. And he is probably the Rajput prince mentioned by HPB. I don't think he was one of the masters, but I think there was some contact between him and Olcott and HPB, definitely. And then whether that led them to the masters or what, but there is some spiritual connection there, which, as you say, there is no tradition of it left in Kashmir. I only learnt of it from Gopalda, actually, from Shri
Krishna Prem. I was just going to ask
you about Gopalda. When I started meeting him in the mid-50s, and one day he said, you know, I was going to Chennai. He said, you know, Tiger, that's what he called me, like my father and others of that generation. He said, if you go to Chennai, you must go to the Theosophical Society because you have a special claim on the Theosophical Society. So I said, what does that mean? So he said, no, you should go. So he also hinted that there was some kind of a link. But perhaps these links are best remain sort of subtle, unknown, rather than over-examined and over-advertised and over-examined and so on. But you have been teaching a lot. You've been going around the world, I notice. And I notice that your teaching involves a lot of yatras. You go off to Haridwar, or you go off to Kailash Mansarovar, you go off to Kurg, or you go off to America, and all, and then a group gathers around you. Is this peripatetic gurudom, if I may call it that, is that part of your style, or is that part of your sadhana?
I have to start discussing this a little earlier, because after spending 3.5 years with Babaji, which is all the time with him, most of
moving.
The time. Yeah, moving, walking. You know, he was really of the kind of person who didn't have a banner or didn't have a organization.
But he was a real person.
A real
not
person.
Not an astral person.
No. Real person.
A physical person.
Physical. And he had a small, only thing he had was a kamandalu and a small white cloth and a big bead of Rudraksha malas on
his head. He was a young man.
He was around, I would say, 25 years old, very fair. And I always suspected that he came from Kashmir. For the simple reason, his eyes were light, his hair was light, but he never kind of, but once he told me to go to Kashmir, I went to Srinagar, I went to, what is this famous?
Shir Bhavani.
Then he said, you should also go and meet Lakshmanju.
Who was living in Nishad.
Who was living at that time.
Yes.
So I went and met him.
Great Shaiva Guru.
Yeah. And so anyway, so when Babaji, after spending this many years, he told me to go back. I said, this is a wonderful life. Why would I go back? I mean, there's no interest.
Were you alone with him or was it with a group?
There were one or two people coming and going sometimes.
But you were the permanent figure.
Yeah. At that time.
At that time.
That period. He believed in having someone for a period of time alone to teach. Unlike my way of looking at teaching.
You're doing the opposite.
No, this is that's what I'm trying to say. So when he said, go back, I said, can you let me stay on like this? It's beautiful. I'll also have a copy. And of course, I couldn't bear the cold like he did. He never even, I've gone with him to Tapovan and Gomukh, but nothing warm. So he said, no, you have to go back. You have to get married. You have to do what normal people do and make your living. Then, when you get the signal to teach, which will come to you, before that, don't open your mouth. I was 38 years old before the signal came. Till then, I never used to open. Of course, some of my old friends knew that I was crazy, that I would go off to the Himalayas and do some funny things, but nobody knew what I had learned or understood. After this, I started teaching after a dream, which take too much time to explain maybe. I saw Babaji wearing the clothes of a railway guard with a green light in his hand.
A very clear indication.
Yeah, and I laughed because he was barefooted in that uniform and he had matted hair and no cap. I burst out laughing in the dream. But he swung that green light and he whistled. And I was sitting in a train on which was written Satsang banner. And as soon as he did this, the train started moving pretty fast. And I was horrified. I jumped up from the dream saying, I'm not going anywhere. But I knew that was a green signal. Same Mohan who sent you the book was responsible also after that. Babaji has used him as a tool many times. He's a jeweler.
Okay.
So I went to do something about my wife's jewelry. And I happened to go there. He said, a friend of yours came from Trivandrum and he says, you have been to the Himalayas and you know many things about the Himalayas. I said, yeah, no, but those days are gone many years ago, you know, trying to put up, because I was told not to talk. So he says, I am a secretary of the Theosophical Society, so can you come and just give a small talk on the Himalayas? Yes, that's okay, your experience. I said, we'll think about it. And I thought I went back to get the jewelry after 1 month, but Mohan told me the other day that I came after 6 months because I was avoiding, you know. And
despite the green light?
No, that after that.
After that,
then I come to Neelbagh, which there was a school run by a person called David Horsborough on the outskirts of Bangalore. I was in charge of that. So that night I had this dream. So when I went to Bangalore next time, I said, okay, we can have a talk. And I went there. I thought it was a small private gathering. There were about 100 people sitting in the Theosophical Society, Bangalore. I was scared because I've never talked in public. So I just sat down. I said to Babaji, you know, things have happened. I'm going to open my mouth. And I looked at the person sitting right in front of me and talked. I told him about my description. I forgot about the rest. And at the end of it, they said it was very nice. Can you do this again? That's how the whole
began the whole process.
Satsang. But this thing about meeting more and more people in the public and all that, you are my guru. You, because of you, you see this and this Rama and Vidyapeeth.
Yes,
and I think that in one's life, one has many gurus. I mean, I am always ready to consider.
I certainly have had many gurus. I've learned a lot from many people, including from you.
Can you tell me something about your earlier contact?
No, my gurus, my mother was a traditional pious lady and we did the usual pujas and all. But my first contact, interestingly enough, came through Dilip Kumar Roy. He wrote a book called Among the Great. And that was interviews with five outstanding personalities. Rabindranath Tagore, Bertrand Russell, Romain Rolland, Sri Aurobindo, and one more, and Gandhiji. And in that, the essay on Sri Aurobindo fascinated me. And in that, there was a mention of two English people living in Mirtola. Above Almora. And one of them was a great friend of the Dilipta. So I wrote a letter. I couldn't get his address, and I wrote a letter to Dilipta and said, I want to know more about them. So he then sent me his second book, Sri Aurobindo Came to Me, in which there were extensive letters between Dilipta and Gopalda and Krishna Prem, and comments by Sri Aurobindo on some of Krishna Prem's letters. Very, very positive comments. Then I wrote to the governor of
May
Uttar
I interrupt
Pradesh.
For a second? Yes. Has Gopalda met Sri Aurobindo? I'm not sure.
Let me see. He certainly met Ramana Maharishi. He did meet, he met the mother.
Okay.
He met the mother, that I know for definite. Because he said, Mother, I want to give myself to Krishna. Help me to give myself to Krishna. The mother said, you already have given yourself to Krishna. He said, no, not enough. So that dialogue, that means he met the mother. I'm not quite sure whether he met Sri Aurobindo or not, but he met Ramana Maharishi.
He did.
And he had the most extraordinary experience because he was sitting there and suddenly Maharishi disappeared. Mm-hmm. And so he closed his eyes again, and when he opened again, he was then there. Maharishi was giving him the message that despite all your love for form and all, ultimately it is form, whatever. So that is his experience. So then I started meeting with Gopalda and Ashishta, his English disciple. and ultimately took Diksha from him. So that's one set of gurus. Before that, there was a Kashmiri Pandit who was what I would call my Shakt Guru. These people were Vaishnava gurus. And then much later, there is an American, Shivaya Subramanya Swami from Hawaii, who is my Shaiva Guru. So I have also learned from a lot of different people, even Peer Vilayat Khan.
I heard that he was a very good friend of yours.
Yes, and he also sort of gave me, and so lots of people one learns from. Life is a learning experience, I think. There's no antim sort of guru, as it were. I suppose you go on life, and they say the greatest guru then is Yama, death, which is also a learning experience.
The entrance to the parikrama to the Kailash Yatra is called Yamadwar.
Yes, you are. you enter, not sure whether you're going to come back.
At your own risk. And I think this is the real spiritual adventure. You won't call it adventure.
It is an adventure, yes.
Yeah. Also, it's a journey. Better put it as a journey. It's like entering Yamadwar. You know, we have no guarantees. We have one guarantee that ultimately, if not in this life, we will touch the goal, depending on one's sincerity and a teacher that one has. A teacher is very, very important. You are talking about how Gopalda went and saw Ramana Maharshi, and Ramana Maharshi disappeared. Well, I have lived with this man, with Babaji. Lived means like this, sitting, talking, and I have seen that he was an extraordinary individual, not only in his what we call deep spiritual content and experience, but also after seeing him, when somebody does little things like Satya Sai Baba's producing ashes and all, I don't consider that as a big thing, because I've seen greater wonders. These are things I and you can do. See, I can also produce ash if I want. It is not a big deal, you understand? So then that becomes a big holy thing to do, and I'll keep it, somebody may have a stomachache. So what I mean to say, these are not such great things. They're very, very simple things. People make big out of that. So I have seen this happen. And I was always discouraged. I was told, his idea was very simple. It is not his idea. This is the idea that is there in the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali in the chapter on Siddhis, Vibhuti Yoga. This is also called Vibhuti.
Vibhuti.
Now, Patanjali says that these are extraordinary capacities that a human being develops as his mind becomes quieter and sharper and deeper. But the goal is different from indulging in these matters.
In fact, the goal is beautifully brought out in the Upanishads, I feel. And what impressed me a great deal about you was your knowledge of the Upanishads. Because you remember, we had an India International Center, I think.
That's right.
We had a session on the Upanishads, and two or three times.
Your knowledge of the Upanishads is just as good.
No, mine is simply sort of intellectual knowledge, you know, whereas you have an experiential knowledge. But yes, I love the Upanishads. For me, the Upanishads are the summum bonum of our wisdom. And whether it is not only jnana, I mean, there is karma, kurvanne vihe karma ani jiji visheti satam samaha. There is bhakti with the umam, hemavatim. And there's all the things, all the genesis of everything else that is in Hinduism today is in the Upanishads. That's what I feel.
That's what I was also told. In fact, Babaji asked me to teach the Upanishads because he said, when people hear the word Upanishad, they immediately think that it's something, you know, for sannyasins and not for all. He said, simplify it. It's not so complicated. Don't you agree with
absolutely,
me that it's
I
so
agree,
crystal
absolutely.
Clear and simple? In
fact, it's a much clearer, they are much clearer texts than the Gita.
Absolutely.
The Gita is a very complex and complicated text. But the Upanishads are clear stream, you know.
So clear.
Shruti, you know, what happens when you achieve a liberation? Vidyate sarva granthischa, chidyante sarva sanshaya, kshiyante chasya karmani yasmin drishte paravare, hiranamaye pare koshe virijam brahma nishkalam, tat shubhram jyotisham jyoti, statat atma vidho vidhu, na tatra suryo bhati, na chandra tarakam, nema vidyato bhanti, kutoyam agnihi, तमेव भान्तु मनुभाति सर्वं तस्य भाषा सर्वमिदं विभाति ब्रह्मैविदम् अमृतं पुरस्तात् ब्रह्म पश्चात् ब्रह्म दक्षिणश्चोत्तरेण अधश्चोर्ध्वं च प्रसृतं ब्रह्मैविदं विश्वमिदं वरिष्ठं. दिस् मैग्निफिसेंट यूनिवर्स,
यू नो, फॉर मी दिस इज वन पार्ट, दैट इज वेयर यू हैव somebody has reached, the rishi is talking about where he has reached. Equal importance must be given, I'm sure you know this, to how the Upanishads start with, you know.
Question.
Question.
Always
in fact,
question.
There is no ancient wisdom scripture in the world which is called Who. The very title is Who. The Keno Upanishad.
Keneshitam
patati prasitam mana. Kena prana prathama prayati yuktaha. Keneshitam vajam imam vedanti. Chakshuchotram ka udeva yunakti. See, it's so profound.
Shvetashvitar starts with a question. The Prashna Upanishad starts with a question.
With a question. Isha Upanishad starts with a statement, but it's almost like a question.
A reply. The Katha Upanishad is a question.
It's a complete question. And so, since we are on this subject, what I don't appreciate much with some of our present day gurus, or what shall we call, is that there is not much scope for questioning. I think the Upanishadic dialogue is the best way.
Essentially for a dialogic, we are a dialogic civilization.
So
unlike some religions
gone,
which are revealed civilizations, you
absolutely
have just have one revelation,
absolutely,
that is it. Take it or leave it.
Leave it.
But here you keep asking. I mean, they ask very sharp questions.
Very sharp questions.
Angirjana, kasminnu bhagavo vigyate sarvavidam vigyatam bhavati. What is that by knowing which everything
else is known?
In fact, what a marvelous question.
Yes. In fact, that is the question. Even the Mundaka Upanishad, when it talks about it, it says there are also others who are merely pandits, who don't understand. And when they lead, it's like, the blind leading the blind, which is an old 2,000-year-old statement, which is now available to us in English. So,
but the guru has two requirements in the Mundaka also. He must be Shrotriyam,
yes,
and Brahmanishtham. Both.
So
both.
That is where, when there is a Brahmanishtha, you see some of these avadhuts and this kind of people, like what you call Paramhamsas, avadhuts, who are just like madmen, they have Brahmanishta.
But they are not Shrotriya.
But they don't have Shrotriya. So therefore, they are not so qualified to teach. This is, so if both are there, then it's a great qualification. But when one is there, I would prefer that they are Brahmanishta rather than Stotriya.
Because Shrotriya can be somebody who's merely
theoretical,
intellectual,
who has studied and he theoretically knows. But when the combination is there, it's Swami Vivekananda, I would classify as both.
And Sri Aurobindo.
Aurobindo, Sri Aurobindo.
Not Ramana. Ramana was Brahmanishtam, but not Shrotriyam to that. Sri Ramakrishna was the same. Brahmanishtam, very much Brahmanishtam, but not Shrotriyam. Vivekananda.
Swamiji. Vivekananda.
Vivekananda was both.
So,
Aurobindo was both. Those are the only two. In fact, one of the books to Sri Aurobindo, I read to Sri Aurobindo, Shrotriyam Brahmanishtam. No, to Krishna Prem, I wrote that. Those are very rare qualities. And if I may say so, you have both of them. I don't certainly have
You are
both
embarrassing
of them.
Me, but I think it's all Babaji's blessings. Whatever experience I've had in the spiritual world, I think without his finding me at the age of 9 and cleaning up my brain, it would have been impossible. Now, while we are talking, I see that bracelet on your hand that
yes.
says Om Namah,
Om Namah
Shivaya.
You see, my philosophy is Vedanta. My bhakti is Shiva. For the last, what is it now, exactly 25 years, I have been worshipping Shiva. And he's been very gracious. And so I was, it's very strange, you know, before that, for about 30 years, I was worshipping Krishna.
Mm.
And then without any trauma, Thakur, as it were, withdrew and Shiva came. And the Nataraja particularly. You see, it's very strange, Muntaz bhai, because coming from the far north, nobody has ever heard of the Nataraja.
Uh-huh.
The first Nataraja temple in North India, probably the last, is the one I've built in Jammu.
Mm-hmm.
Then we did
a temple in Jammu?
In Jammu, yes, in the Raghunath Mandir, beautiful temple, mm-hmm, where I had a huge crystal shivling. And then I built one in America in Swami Sachidananda's ashram. And the third one I have just built, as I explained
to you, on the way to Pondicherry,
village Pudukup.
That's also a Nataraja.
That's a Nataraja, in a pyramid. Now, why would it be that somebody coming from the barbaric north, who doesn't know a word of Tamil or any one of the sources, I've been obsessed, as it were, with Nataraja, and that's why, and I love the Tamil food, I love the Hindolan, I love the Mohanam, I love the music, I love them. So it's some Purva Janma Sanskar, I think. This link
to the Shaivite tradition of the south.
Of the south. Siddhanta. And which is very similar to the Kashmir Shaivism, but Kashmir Shaivism didn't know the Nataraja. For me, the Nataraja, the dance and the music, is the essential quality of Shiva.
The music, meaning the devotional aspect, and the dance.
And the actual music and the devotional aspect. Yeah.
In fact, this time at the Shivratri, every Shivratri we have a satsang in Madanapalli.
Mm-hmm.
People gather from everywhere. We have a dhuni going. Okay. Since Babaji was a Nath, I am basically,
you also a Nath,
basically a Nath Panthi. So at least for functions, I have to keep a dhuni. We are supposed to keep a dhuni always. But the dhuni is here now. Actually, that dhuni is a symbol of this.
Oh, the inner dhuni.
The inner fire. But at least on ceremonial occasions, we keep a dhuni. So this time, we discussed this matter about Shiva, Shivratri. I said, one of the important reasons why Shivratri is considered a special day, it is considered to be the day when Shiva did his Tandava Nrita.
The Ananda Tandava.
Ananda Tandava. In Ananda and also in a destructive aspect.
The Natanam Adinar, that song, you know.
Yeah. So that is the dance of Tandava. The Tandava Nrita is actually a dance of breaking down of all images.
It's a dance of the cosmos.
Dance of the cosmos. It's in fact, the world is called Jagat because it is moving always. Jagatyam. Ishavasi Upanishad.
Jagatyam
Jagat. Because it is Jagat. Jagatyam, therefore it's called Jagat. Now, Shiva is a representation of the essence of all these movements. And to come to that, therefore, we have also to shed all the images that we have gathered over the years, over many births, and all the images are shed, then what remains after this neti process of when we allow Shiva to really do a free dance is that he puts his foot on our heart. So therefore, this is what we had a discussion about. In fact, I was wondering, every year we have Shivratri, what am I going to say? As usual, I went with a clean slate, I sat down, I said, we'll see. And then Babaji always does this to me. I'm not a medium, not that way. I don't like mediums, but something happens in the brain. And in fact, my friend Mohan has a weird theory. He thinks, before a talk, I go to the bathroom and something happens there. That's because you have to sit for long periods, so I like to visit.
That's always good. Yes, well, I think that what we have to do is to round up this discussion with the basic question. Can one live a spiritual life along with a very active outer life? Now, this is always the question. Some people feel that, no, you need to withdraw, you need to become silent, you need to. But the sort of situation in which I find myself, I mean, I now, by God's grace, in a few days, I'll be 79 or nearing, pushing 80. And I find myself outwardly more active than ever. Now, I don't know whether that is a good thing. Should I start withdrawing, or do you think I should continue with my activities?
I have to explain this in a little different way. Each individual. Now, spiritual growth is an individual affair. It's not a mass. It's not franchise that you have, like Coffee Day or something like that. Nowadays, we shouldn't talk about Coffee Day, but whatever. So, it is individual. Each teacher has to choose a student and work. And this is because each human being is made differently. I mean, there are some general characteristics which are same, but there are some specifics which are very different. Now, there are some people for whom it is required or necessary to retire into solitude and become spiritual. On the other hand, you will see this also in the Upanishads. There are people who have to live in the world, do a lot of good to the society and develop spiritually. Now, these are not opposed to each other, but these are the different kind of sadhaks. Janaka is one who
is
lived
in
the world. Yes. So now, also take Swami Vivekananda. He was a man who loved a life of retirement, but he wanted to teach. He wanted to bring about some change, and he was very sorry for the suffering people of this world. So even though he was a sannyasin, he decided to
travel around the world,
except that he didn't have his own house or his own car, and that he didn't have a wife and children. He had all other paraphernalia which an ordinary householder has.
I feel a strong affinity to Vivekananda.
Yes. If you go to Belur Math and see his bedroom, it's many times better than my bedroom. There's a beautiful four-poster bed. That does not detract from Swami Vivekananda's value in any way. Now, Ramakrishna was not like that. That's a different story. So what I'm trying to say is different people have that. And I think if you ask me, having known you for some years now, you can, even if you retire and try to do this, your nature is like that. You have to come
out.
This
is what my children say. They say, if you go for retirement, you'll be back within 72 hours.
No, I won't say that.
You're incapable of staying alone.
No, it's not.
Hours.
Your nature is like that. It is full of energy. And that energy has to be transferred. It has to benefit somebody. Now, I think what you can do at this stage is that you can spend some periods when you are in solitude. Take off some time when you will not have any official business or anything that normally one is associated with. And then do only your contemplation. I'm sure you can find many such places. And then need not even be a guru.
In fact, I've already built my Shiv Kutir, my Vanaprastha cottage, but I haven't visited it for 5 years. I'm going this year. Now I'll go every year.
Right. Now you must go and spend some time there. And what you get there, you should translate. You must bring into the world. You must talk to people. You must help them out. But this is required, I think, at this stage. I'm not a great man to say this, but...
No, but it's important what your views on this matter are.
I think so. And not that you should completely retire and sit down. That's not. I think until and unless your physical body allows you to move around, you should do it. Because you are not doing it only for yourself. At some point of time, you must consider it as a divine duty and do it. This is what I would say. My suggestion. Humble suggestion.
And this also links, of course, with broader questions that Raja was raising, but which I don't think we can possibly deal with. First of all, the destiny of man, you know, where are we ultimately headed? Where is the human race headed? And that brings in the whole evolutionary paradigm and, you know, Sri Aurobindo's theory and Taiya Dishardhan's theory and humanity, how it's going to go there. And also whether in the global society that's emerging, the role of spirituality can begin once again to be highlighted in a different context. Because all the religions and all arose thousands of years ago in a different context. Now, in the modern context, in the global society, that's what I try to do in my own small way, is to articulate the Upanishadic concepts in terms of our present dilemmas and our present problems.
Yes, I think you should continue to do that. I think it's a very important issue because one of the reasons is there are very few people today, I don't know if there are any, who are in the thick of political, I won't say political in that sense of the term.
Public life.
Public life, who are really deep down interested in spiritual matters, unfortunately. So if someone has that, I think, I hope Babaji keeps showering his blessings that it continues. I think it is very important. Even I, basically, I am a very retiring. Today I was discussing this with, I think Bela came to pick me up. I like to retire. I don't like to come out. I don't like to meet people. My mother now, even now, wonders how I'm handling and how I'm managing these things because I'm never free from anybody. I mean, there are lots of people always coming. I have to see them. Left to myself, I like to retire, go into the forest or in a kutir and sit quietly. Babaji said, he said, after so many years with me, even after those 3.5 continuous years, I used to go every year for a few months to see him, till he passed away in 85. One day when I expressed this to him, that why do you want me to teach? But why do you want me to get into family? This, he said, after so many years, I thought you must have shed some of your selfishness. It looks like you haven't. I was pained by it when he said that. And I looked and I said, he's right. Because he used to always tell me, if somebody calls you a fool, don't get upset. Go and look at the mirror, you might be a fool. You know. So I thought about that and I said, he's right. I have to...
He shed his body in 85, you see.
1985, in some place between Rishikesh and Nilkant, which he didn't even allow me to put up a tomb or some marking. But I know where it is. When we went for our trip to Rishikesh, it's there between Nilkant and Rishikesh.
And you've written somewhere that he will meet with you only at the end,
yes,
when your life is at... Yes. Coming to an end. Yes.
But I have kind of a mental, I don't know, it is mental, it is deep down a link with Babaji. But physical appearance. He said that he will come back and see me when I go. So I only hope that I am not going in a hospital, because then others will also see him.
They won't see him even in any case, because he may not be.
No, maybe it is a good idea also.
I have a friend, or not a disciple, a sort of somebody who's learning something from me, who has a theory. I keep talking that I haven't seen Shiva and I haven't seen Lord Shiva. Why haven't I seen him? He will also only see you at your last moment.
Yeah.
That is when you're going to see. Because when Vivekananda, if you remember, when he went to Amarnath,
yeah,
that's when he had the overwhelming vision of Lord Shiva. And after that, within 3 months, he passed away.
In fact, when he went to Amarnath and came back, Sister Nivedita was the only one who was with him. And when he came out with his bloodshot eyes and completely abstracted, she said to him, I don't know the exact words, but it means this, that Swamiji, you have done such a great deal of work for the world, and spiritual and material. It's tremendous. And he said to her, I did nothing. I did absolutely nothing. He said, there was this Kali, you know, who sits in Dakshineswar. She was sitting on my shoulders and doing everything. But I have shook her off. Now there's nothing now. So she said, now what? He said, Shivoham, Shivoham. Yeah. And then she said to herself, I think he will go soon. Because she had heard somebody say, the moment he says Shivoham, he's going.
So maybe that is correct. I hope it's correct. Like, you're hoping that Babaji will come at the end.
For me, Babaji has guaranteed.
Guaranteed.
For you, I am sure.
I have no such guarantee, unfortunately. But there's a hope.
Who knows? I don't make a distinction between Babaji and Shiva. You know, in the Nath Sampradaya, the founder of the whole Sampradaya is supposed to be Adinath, who is Shiva himself. And then Machendranath, and then Gorakhnath.
Gorakhnath and the rest.
So, the idea of the Nath Pant is to meditate upon your guru, considering him as no different from Adinath, which is Shiva. So, we are in the same boat.
So, let me say it's been a pleasure to talk with you, and our good friend Raja Chaudhary will have immortalized us for posterity.
Thank you very much. It has also been a great privilege for me to be interviewed with you, having a dialogue.
We've had many discussions one-on-one,
but
this time it's
not
under the floodlights.
And that also thanks to Raja Chaudhary,
yes,
a good friend.
But I think that...
A good friend, a sadhak himself. That's very important, because otherwise...
With all his jovial characteristics, at heart he's a deep sadhak,
he's a
sadhak. No doubt about it.
So
anyhow, so we leave it at that.
Yes, sir. Thank you very
Namah
much.
Namah Shivaya. Thank
and
you.
Since your Shiva is your...
Ishtadev.
Ishtadevata. And since, as a token of knowing this, one more little demonstration, and you can keep this Rudraksha for yourself. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Shall we shake hands?
Thank you.